Hello everyone, this is Dixit Bhatt this side from Team OYG. On behalf of team, I welcome you all on this virtual platform. Today we have a wonderful speaker, Prachi Avasthi with us. Ma'am has going to talk about the pros and cons of food preservation today. Ma'am is pursuing her master's in nutrition and food processing from the SDNT College, Pune. Ma'am has done bachelor's in food and technology from Lady Irwin College from Delhi. And in her hobbies, ma'am was a part of the theatre society during the graduation and performed in various inter-college theatre competitions as well. Also, ma'am has participated in Eat Right Mela organized by FSSAI. And currently, ma'am is doing the internship with the Food Technons as a business development intern. Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving your time and connecting with us. Now, without further ado, I would like you to, ma'am, take over the session and continue with the session.
So thank you, Own Your Growth, for having me here. And thank you for the introduction. So let's start with the session. I will just share my screen.
Sure, ma'am.
So I hope my screen is visible.
Ma'am, it's not yet visible. I cannot see it yet. Yes, ma'am. We can see it now. It's visible.
Is it moving?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So good afternoon, everyone. Today, I'm going to present on the topic, the pros and cons of food preservation, and most importantly, how these methods of preservation affected our health. So as food technology students, we are constantly surrounded by this term, which is food preservation. Also, this is a common household term, and it has been with us since ancient times. So you must have seen your nannies, dadis, and even your moms making pickles and putting them in glass jars and drying chilies, popcorns, and what else? Potato chips on a hot sunny day. So let me just introduce you to what food preservation is. Any of a number of methods by which food is kept from spoilage after harvest or slaughter. So spoilage is the term that may be used to describe a process that makes the food unfit or ill for human consumption. So there are various methods of food preservation. Among the oldest methods of preservation are drying, refrigeration, and fermentation. And modern methods include canning, pasteurization, freezing, irradiation. So I will be explaining these methods one by one as we move forward. Then advances in packaging materials have played an important role in modern food preservation, as food packaging can retard product deterioration. Also, food packaging ensures that the product maintains its quality and it increases the shelf life of the food product, where the shelf life may be defined as a term that it is a time period within which the food product is safe for human consumption. Then there are various factors that affect the quality of food products, which are contamination by microorganisms like bacteria and fungi, then infestation by insects. This may be due to improper handling or storing of the food product. Moisture, light, and temperature also plays an important factor on affecting the quality of the food product. So you may have observed that when you open a packet of chips, especially in a monsoon season. So that packet of chips becomes stale and non-crispy after some time. That is because the product has absorbed moisture in it. Also, a danger zone has been mentioned in the slide, which is 5 degrees Celsius to 62 degrees Celsius. So this is the temperature range within which the bacteria or the microorganisms grows at the fastest rate. So to prevent this, you have to keep your food products either below 5 degrees Celsius or above 62 degrees Celsius so as to maintain the quality of the food product. Then there are physical and chemical changes, which include physical damage that may occur during harvesting, processing, or distribution. So the damage increases the chance of chemical and biological spoilage because of the protective layer getting bruised or broken. So microorganisms find it easy to enter the cells of the plant and thus resulting in the deterioration of the quality. Also, degradation by endogenous enzymes. So endogenous enzymes are the enzymes that are already present in the food. The most common example of the chemical change is enzymatic browning. So you must have observed that when you cut an apple, the surface of the apple after some time becomes brown. That is because of the enzymatic browning, and the enzyme responsible for this is polyphenol oxidase, which is also known as PPO. So this enzyme causes the oxidation reaction and thus eventually resulting into the browning reaction. So a tomato, an image of a tomato has been attached. So in this, you can see on the right hand side, a tomato has become pliable or squishy. That is because of the probably of the chemical reactions that are taking place within the tomato. And then there are methods of food preservation. So the science of preserving foods for more than few days is what is defined as food processing. So there are six major methods of food processing, which is canning, drying or dehydration, freezing, freeze drying, fermentation, and irradiation. So I will be explaining these methods one by one. So canning, also known as appertization, because in honor of Nicholas Eppert, who developed this process of canning. So if I tell you about the history of canning, it is the Napoleon asked its people to develop a more reliable method of food preservation, so as to provide quality food products to their soldiers who were at the war at that time. So Nicholas Eppert, who was a confectioner and a baker, he observed that when he kept his product in glass jars, airtight glass jars, and he heated those jars, he observed that his product maintained its quality for quite a long time. So he proposed this idea to the government and he was rewarded for the same. So the process of canning is sometimes called sterilization because of the heat treatment of food that eliminates all the microorganisms. Most commercial canning operations are based on the principle that bacteria destruction increases tenfold for each 10 degrees Celsius increase in temperature. So let's say I increase the temperature from 115 degrees Celsius to 125 degrees Celsius. So the destruction of the bacteria will increase by tenfold. Canning means hermetically sealing cooked food in sterile bottles and cans. So by hermetically sealing, I mean that it is airtightly sealed. The container is boiled and this keeps or weakens the bacteria. Food are cooked for various lengths or time. So there is a time temperature relationship between the canning process. But there is one limitation of canning, that once you open a can or bottle, the food is again at risk of spoilage. So to prevent this, you have to keep that food product in a refrigerator. Then the other method is freezing. The frozen foods have the advantage of resembling the fresh product more closely than the same food preserved by other techniques. So other techniques involve the application of heat. So freezing has an advantage of closely resembling the food product, because it does not involve the application of heat. Freezing preserves food by preventing microorganisms from multiplying. The process does not kill all types of bacteria. So in this process, the bacteria or the microorganisms are still present, but they are in their inactivated form. Enzymes in the frozen state remain active, although at a reduced rate. Vegetables are blanched or heated in preparation for freezing to ensure enzyme inactivity and thus to avoid degradation of flavor. So blanching is a process that is done prior to freezing. It is a process that inactivates the enzyme. So in blanching, you just dip fruits or vegetables in hot boiling water for 3 to 5 minutes and then immediately transfer it to cold water. So this process inactivates the enzyme. There are two methods of freezing, which is quick freezing and slow freezing. So in quick freezing, the ice crystals are smaller, producing less cell damage than in the slowly frozen products. So you must have observed that when you prepare ice cream at home, there is a difference in the texture and the taste, which is different from the ice cream you have purchased from the market. That is because the freezer which you have at home follows the principle of slow freezing. So slow freezing produces large ice crystals, and it causes more cell damage to the product. Then there are other methods like drying and dehydration. So there is a difference between drying and dehydration. Drying is a natural process which involves the heat from sun to remove the moisture from the food product. It does not have any control over climatic conditions. More space is required for drying, but it is less expensive. But there is a major disadvantage of this process, that contamination from dust, insects, and birds may occur in this. Dehydration, on the other hand, is an artificial process that involves the dehydrators within the food industries. It has a control over rate of removal of water. Less space is required because it occurs within chambers, and sanitary conditions are controlled within a dehydration process, but it is more expensive. So in dehydration, there are less chances of contamination from dust, insects, and birds. So dehydration and drying follows the same principle, which is microorganisms like bacteria, fungi, more requires water for their growth and multiplication. So in this process, water acts as a potential vehicle for pathogens. So it has to be moisture or water. There are these vegetable or the fruit. Hello, is there any problem?
Yeah, it was just a network issue in between. So your voice was not audible properly in between that. So can you just start by the pathogens again?
By which slide?
Yeah, this slide, and you were talking about the pathogens.
Pathogen, okay. So as I was saying, that dehydration and drying follows the same principle, which is the microorganisms like bacteria, fungi, and mold, they require water for their growth. So in this, water acts as a potential vehicle for pathogens in the food chain. So it has to be removed to increase the shelf life of the food products. So dehydration and drying removes the water vapor or moisture from the food product in order to increase the shelf life of the product. Then there are some common types of dehydrators or dryers, which is used in food industries, one of which is tray dryer. So tray dryer typically function in batch mode. It comprises of racks to hold product. Heating is attained by an air current circulating across the trays by conduction from heated trays or heated shelves on which the trays lie. So most tray dryers are heated by air, which revolves around the moist vapors. So tray dryers are very useful for the small production rate, or also it has an advantage that it dries most of the wide range of the products. Drying operation in case of tray dryers are slow, and it requires huge labor force for loading and unloading. So you can say that it is one of the limitations of the tray dryer. So in the image, as you can see, a centrifugal fan is placed, and just in front of the centrifugal fan, there is a heater that makes the air warm. And this warm air is circulated across the trays, and this removes the moist vapors from the food product. Then the other common dryer is roller, or also known as drum dryer. The rotatory dryer is essentially a cylinder disposed marginally to the horizontal, which may be rotated, or the shell may be stationary, and an agitator inside may revolve slowly. So as you can see in the image, there is the drum. So either the drum will rotate, or an agitator which is placed inside the drum, it will rotate. In this, the food is spread over the surface of a heated drum. The drum rotates with the food being applied to the drum at one part of the cycle. The food remains on the drum surface for the greater part of the rotation so as to increase the heat transfer rate, during which time the drying takes place and then is scraped off. So a scraper, which is known as doctor's knife, is placed just above the product collecting drum, and this scrapes off the food product. Drum dryers takes viscous liquids, slurries, suspension, and paste as input material to be dried, and produces the output as powders or flakes. So if you have added tomato puree as a feed, so it will produce tomato powders as an end product. The other, or the last type of dryer which is used in food industries, is spray dryer. So in spray dryer, air and solids acts as an input, may move in parallel or counterflow. So either the air and the solid will move in one direction, or they will move in opposite direction. Drying occurs very rapidly, so that this process is very useful for materials that are damaged by exposure to heat for any appreciable length of time. So this method is mostly useful for heat sensitive food products. The dryer body is large, so that the particles can settle as they dry without touching the walls on which they might otherwise stick. Spray dryer generally used to prepare milk, coffee, and fruit juice powder. So spray dryers generally takes liquid food as an input, and then it produces powdered form of product. So an atomizer is attached just below the feed, where the feed is added. So atomizer acts as a mist producing instrument, which is very similar to the one that is present on the top of the perfume bottle. Then the other method of preservation, and this is the modern method of preservation, which is now being used in the food industries, is freeze drying, a processing method that uses a combination of freezing and dehydration. Foods that already have been frozen are placed in a vacuum-tight enclosure and dehydrated under vacuum conditions with careful application of heat. So normally ice melts and becomes water when heat is applied. So if more heat is applied, it turns to steam. But in freeze drying, the ice turns directly to vapor and there is a very little chance for the microorganisms to grow. So as you can see in the image, a freeze drying process has been explained. So if you wish to dry a soup, soup consists of ingredients, soup solids and water. So the first process for freeze drying will be freezing the soup. So this will freeze the water present in the soup and it will change it into its ice form. So this ice will then be dehydrated in a vacuum chamber. Why vacuum chamber? So that there is very little interaction between the air and the food product. So the dehydrator dehydrates the food product and this ice is directly converted to its vapor form. This follows the principle of sublimation, which is changing the phase, solid phase into directly its vapor phase without transferring it to into its liquid state. So this is how a freeze-dried product is formed and it is very concentrated. This process removes mostly 93 to 98% of the vapor. Freeze-dried products require very little space for storage and transportation. So this is one of the advantages of this technique. They do not need to be refrigerated, but they must be reconstituted with water before they are ready to consume. The most common form of freeze-dried food is instant coffee, which you can easily purchase from the market. Also, freeze-drying technique has made its way to space. Astronauts in International Space Station are provided freeze-dried food products, and this is a common type of freeze-drying products that has been provided to the astronauts. So this has an advantage as these are very convenient and they require very little space to store and they do not need to be refrigerated. Then the other most common method or the modern method which is now being used is irradiation. So irradiation is a process of using ionizing radiations that will maintain the quality of the food for longer periods of time. The process exposes food particles to gamma rays or X-rays. These rays have higher penetration power than alpha rays and beta rays, which were used before in the food industry. The rays have the ability to penetrate deeply into a food, interacting with its atoms and molecules and causing some chemical and biological effects that could possibly decrease its rate of decay. Irradiation also has an ability to sanitize foods by destroying contaminants like bacteria, yeast, molds, and even insects. Irradiation delays ripening of fruits and vegetables, and it also inhibits the sprouting in bulbs and tubers. So as you can see in the image, onion and potatoes have undergone sprouting process, which are kept on the right-hand side, but the ones which are kept on the left-hand side have not undergone this sprouting process, maybe because they have undergone this irradiation process. Also, irradiated food products have a logo called Radura, which has to be green in color, and it looks like this. So it is mandatory to mention the logo along with the tagline treated by irradiation so that the consumer makes an informed choice. The other method of preservation or the other methods of preservation, which is most common, is salting. So salting of fish and pork has long been practiced using either dry salt or brine. So brine is nothing but a salt solution. So how does salt preserve the food? Salt enters the tissue and binds the water and thus lowering the water activity. So water activity is the amount of free water that is available for the microorganisms to grow. So as microorganisms require water, so as we decrease the water available for the microorganism, we are eventually reducing the growth of the microorganism within the food. Then most among the widely used method is smoking, which frequently is added to preserve fish, ham, and sausage. The chemicals in the smoke, formaldehyde and certain alcohols, and the dehydration acts as a preservative agent. Smoking usually is intended to flavor the product as well as to preserve it. So if you have consumed smoked chicken, so you know the difference between how does the smoked chicken taste like and how chicken which has been cooked under pressure cooker tastes like. So smoking not only preserves the food product, it also imparts flavor to the food product. So this is a typical smokehouse. Grates are closed and smoke is obtained from by burning the woods. Sugar is another preservative agent, which is a major ingredient of jams and jellies. So for effective preservation, the total sugar content should make up at least 65% of weight of the final product. So to determine the total sugar content or to determine the total soluble solid, an instrument called refractometer is used, which has an eyepiece and a prism on which a thin smear is made, and then it is covered by a covering lid. So this refractometer has a unit of degree bricks. So if a product contains at least 65% of the weight of the final product, it will be written as 65 degree bricks. Then sugar acts in much the same way as salt, which inhibits the bacterial growth by lowering the water activity of the product. Then how does packaging benefits the food preservation technique? The packaging of processed food is just as important as the process itself. So think of it this way, that you have purchased dried apple slices, which are not packed. So although the apple slices have undergone a process of dehydration or drying, but you are not sure that that product is 100% safe or for you to consume it. Why? Because it may be contaminated by dust, insects, or it may be contaminated by the microorganisms. So packaging ensures that the product is 100% safe. Also, to withstand the heat and cold of processing and the wear and tear of handling and transportation, packaging materials must be strong enough. The fermentation is also a common method which is used to preserve the food. Fermentation not just prolongs the shelf life of food products, but it also adds the advantages like improving the sensory properties of food and even improves the nutritional value of that food item. Fermentation is a process in which breakdown of carbohydrates takes place in presence of microbes, resulting in formation of alcohol or acid. So if fermentation process takes place in the presence of bacteria, it will produce lactic acid, or if the fermentation process takes place in the presence of yeast, it will produce alcohol from the carbohydrates. So what is the process of fermentation? How this happens? So a starter culture containing the preferred bacteria is introduced to the foods to be fermented. A starter culture can be obtained from already produced fermented products. So if you make yogurt at home, you take jamun from already produced dahi, and then you mix it with warm milk and you keep it overnight in room temperature. So a starter culture helps in introduced to the foods to increase the fermentation process. How fermentation preserves the food? The desirable bacteria cause less deterioration of the food by inhibiting the growth of the spoiling types of bacteria. Some fermenting processes lower the pH of foods, preventing harmful microorganisms to live with too acidic environments. So many microorganisms, including the bacteria, find it very difficult to survive in an acidic environment. So the fermentation bacteria or the fermenting bacteria reduces the pH of the food product, and it helps to improve the quality of the food product. But what happens when fermentation process is stopped? The fermentation process can be stopped by other means of preserving, like canning, drying, and freezing. So canning and drying involves the application of heat, whereas freezing involves the application of cold. These processes stop the fermenting process by slowing or killing the preferred microorganisms and other bacteria. So by this process, even the desirable bacteria are killed along with the undesirable bacteria. But some microorganisms manages to survive in that environment as well. So they continue to grow, and that is why fermented products get spoiled if not kept at suitable or desirable conditions. Additional benefits of fermenting are: fermenting enhances the flavor of some foods, creates the distinctive flavors, as you can see in the aged wine or aged cheese, aged beer. So they taste different from recently produced or manufactured wine, beer, and cheese. Fermentation increases nutritional values, like the sprouting of grains, seeds, and nuts increases the amino acid, vitamin, and mineral content. So the fermenting bacteria produces majorly water-soluble vitamins like vitamin B and C, and also they produces an enzyme protease, which breaks down the protein into its monomeric unit, which is amino acid. It increases the digestibility since the microbial enzymes break down the legume protein and enhances cooking process. So if the fermentation process is happening in a carbohydrate containing product, it will break down the carbohydrate into its monomeric unit, which is sugars. And if it is occurring in a protein-based product, it will break down into its monomeric unit, amino acid. Fermented dairy products like cheese, yogurt can be consumed by people who are lactose intolerant. So as we know that lactose intolerant people find it very difficult to digest a sugar, which is lactose. So because they lack an enzyme, which is lactase in their small intestine. So fermented dairy products convert lactose into lactic acid and it is easily digestible within the body. Fermented foods are rich in probiotic bacteria. Probiotic supplements, which are beneficial bacterial cultures for microbial balance in the body, helps in fighting cancer and other diseases like urinary tract infection. So you must have seen a TV commercial ad which states that a probiotic drink has good bacteria which kills the bad bacteria. So probiotic has a benefit in aiding their digestion process and improving the immune system of an individual. But so till now, we have seen the methods of food preservation and how these methods have benefited us. But now we will be looking at the downside of these methods. So first one is the fermentation process. Commercially available fermented foods are typically pasteurized and heated to high temperatures, which means they lack any useful microorganisms as mentioned before. But the exception is the commercial yogurts and other fermented dairy foods manages to have the desirable bacteria because they do not undergo the pasteurization process. Another disadvantage is the high sodium levels in many fermented foods. And as we know that high sodium level increases the risk of heart disease, and it also increases the high blood pressure within the body. Under some conditions, harmful microbes may also cause undesirable effects from the ingestion of fermented foods in certain conditions, such as mycotoxicosis and botulism. So mycotoxicosis is a disease which is accumulation of toxins within the body, and it is caused majorly by a fungi which produces toxins. And botulism is caused by a very pathogenic microorganism or bacteria, which is Clostridium botulinum, which causes paralysis and may even cause death if remain untreated. So is canned food bad for your health? So canning gained popularity because it managed to increase the shelf life of the food product from months to even years. But it is very important to pay attention to added sodium and sugar levels, which uses brine and sugar syrups. So ready-made soups and pastas are considered the most unhealthy products as they contain highest levels of sodium. Some vitamins can be damaged due to high heat processing. So highly sensitive vitamins like vitamin C and vitamin B1, which is also known as thiamine, are damaged due to this processing. Peeled or skinned vegetables and fruits that are packed in brine or syrup tend to lose most of the antioxidants and fiber. So peels of the fruits and vegetables contains most of the antioxidants. So these are lost as we remove them for the canning process. So healthiest canned foods are usually made of single food item and have least amount of added salts and sugars. So how does frozen food products affect our health? More than 70% of the sodium we consume comes from processed and prepared foods like frozen meals. Frozen foods have side effects as they contain hydrogenated palm oil that has harmful trans fat. So trans fatty acid has an ability to increase the low density lipoprotein, which is also termed as bad cholesterol. And it lowers the high density lipoprotein, which is termed as good cholesterol. So people are now restricting or cutting their diet of consuming trans fatty acid. Preservatives like starch, corn syrup, which is made up of glucose, are added to these foods and are noted as carcinogenic substances, which may cause cancer. So starch and corn syrup is added to frozen food products in order to make them look fresh. So that is also starch. Since starch is a polymer of glucose, it is eventually broken down into its monomeric unit, which is glucose, and glucose increases the blood sugar level within the body. Frozen foods are very high in fat. So fat contains twice the number of calories compared to carbohydrates or protein, and thus contributing to weight gain. So you will be surprised to know that fat gives 9 kilocalories per gram as compared to carbohydrate and proteins, which gives 4 kilocalories per gram. So since fat contains twice the number of calories, it contributes to the weight gain. Then the disadvantage of freeze-drying process. Freeze-dried food contains more calories than their original product. So think about it this way, that if one cup of fresh fruits contains or gives 100 calories, so when you freeze-dry same amount of fruit, it will shrink in size. So one cup of freeze-dried fruit will contain more calories and the more pieces of fruit. So since freeze-dried food lack water, around 93 to 98% of water, they are highly concentrated. So nutrition experts recommend that freeze-dried foods might be added as a supplement to someone's diet, but should not act as a replacement for fresh foods. So if you have an option of consuming fresh fruits and vegetables, so why not choose that option? Then this will be the last slide of my presentation. It is the effects of irradiation on food. Some foods such as dairy foods and eggs cannot be irradiated because it causes changes in flavor or texture. Irradiation can alter the nutrient content of some foods because it reduces the level of some of the B group vitamins, like the highly sensitive vitamin, which is vitamin B1, also known as thiamine. Some irradiation does not inactivate dangerous toxins, which have already been produced by bacteria prior to irradiation. Also, the risk of recontamination of food after irradiation is very serious. So once you open the pack of irradiated food product, there are very high chances of being it recontaminated. Irradiation can cause mutation in bacteria and viruses, leading to potential resistance strains. So that is due to the overexposure of the ionizing radiations to the bacteria that eventually causes mutations. So that's it from my side. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a lovely presentation and lovely slides you presented. So we thoroughly enjoyed the session. Ma'am, there are a few questions I wanted to ask you. First question is that, ma'am, how you are attracted towards this field? What was that spark?
So you can say that I got enrolled myself to this course by chance, as I gave NEET after my 12th boards exams. So I did not score really well, but I was offered dental colleges. But at the same time, University of Delhi published its cutoff list. So I was just going through the list of courses I was eligible for. Then I saw that Lady Irwin College has introduced this new course, which is BSc Honours in Food Technology. And it was their first batch. So I searched about this course and I find it very interesting. Also, you can say that it was my dream, or I was very fascinated by the food manufacturing industries. So our school used to take us to biscuit manufacturing industry, and they took us to the mother dairy plant. So I was very fascinated about how these industries work. So somehow I managed to fulfill my childhood dream.
So ma'am, I think we got lucky that we have you today, as you have, by chance, you get the opportunity to learn, but we are lucky that you came in this field and we get the knowledge from you, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Ma'am, one question is that, according to you, what is the importance of natural healthy lifestyle?
There are many important ways of, you know, they are very important. This is important to follow a natural, healthy lifestyle. As you can see in this pandemic times, people are now only focusing on healthy lifestyle. So when the vaccines were not developed, people were trying to eat or consume healthy food products or immune boosting food products like turmeric, ginger, spinach, yogurt, which are few of the immunity boosting food products. So people are now focusing more on healthy lifestyle rather than consuming these preserved or processed food products.
Yes, ma'am. And as we are the community of naturopathy, so I would like you your views according to naturopathy. What do you think naturopathy is?
What I think naturopathy is, I may not be much aware of this term. So.
Okay. So as we are the naturopathy doctors, so I rephrase my question that according to you, what is the future will be of naturopathy?
Is naturopathy using natural food products to treat a human being?
Yeah, it's using the natural treatments or nature to cure the patient. We use all the natural treatments like mud, water, and even the diet is an important part of naturopathy. So we use, without medicine, we treat a patient. That is what naturopathy is.
Okay, so we are aware that these medicines have their own side effects, like taking steroids or taking medicines they have their own side effects. So since these food products do not cause any of the side effects within the body, so they must have the benefit.
Yes, ma'am. And last question from my side, that as all the interns and doctors are listening, also students are listening to you right now. So what are your last words or the last suggestion or guidance for the future to all of the students who are listening?
So I would say that just focus on natural, leading a natural lifestyle. And since I have told that these processed food products have their own disadvantages or the cons, so why not, if you have an option of consuming fresh fruits and vegetables, which provides you more nutrition, which provides you more benefits, so why not consume that?
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was really a great session and great talking with you. And I would like you to, you know, in the future, right now the situation is like we are doing online. So if we get a chance in future, all the things work back normal. We would like you to take as an, you know, personal session with our students and all the interns. So it would be a great opportunity for all of us.
Thank you so much. It was a great opportunity.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving us your time and joining with us.
Thank you so much for having me here.